Welcome to segment 2, Cost Effectiveness Analysis, Approach and Incremental Cost Effectiveness Ratios. In segment 1, you considered why cost effectiveness analysis can be useful. In this segment, you'll learn how the cost effectiveness idea is translated into an outcome metric, the incremental cost effectiveness ratio. First, let's discuss the central cost effectiveness analysis approach. We look at the incremental cost per standardized unit of health gain. This could be the added cost per death averted of life year gained. For whatever intervention you're assessing, you have to compare to another identified course of action. That course of action may be a standard practice like visiting doctors, or it may be a less expensive or less intensive intervention. Whatever the comparison, it always has to be specified. I want to emphasize that this is one of the critical elements of doing a cost-effective analysis correctly, saying what you are comparing to what. No intervention can be properly considered in isolation. It is also important to note that cost-effectiveness ratio, the cost per standardized unit of health gain, is the inverse of health gain per increment of spending. If you get more added health per increment of spending, then you are spending less per added unit of health. The key outcome metric for cost effectiveness analysis is the incremental cost effectiveness ratio. This is the difference in cost, represented as delta cost, divided by the difference in health outcomes. The differences are between two possible actions, here called A and B. Thus, the incremental cost-effectiveness ratio is the cost of one option, A minus the cost option B, all divided by the difference in life years. As I said, everything's comparative. I want to talk more about the need for comparison by showing an example of what happens without comparison. Let's say I want to examine the cost effectiveness of drug A in this table. A person takes drug A and it costs $12,000, and that person lives 40 years. Yet it's clearly misleading to assign all of this health, these 40 years, to drug A, because without drug A, the person would still live 38 life years. Thus, to understand the value of drug A, we should not divide $12,000 by 40 and say that $300 is cost of drug A per added year of life. Instead, what we care about is the change in health due to the intervention. So, we need a comparison, an option B, so that we can think about the incremental cost in life years. You can't calculate the incremental cost effectiveness ratio when you have only one option. It has to be comparative. The incremental cost effectiveness ratio numerator is the net costs, and that's different from the costs of implementation. Net cost is program costs adjusted for the resulting changes in medical costs. Medical costs can fall if you avert disease. With a prevention strategy such as vaccination or HIV prevention through needle exchange, if you avert disease, you save the cost of treating that disease. On the other hand, sometimes an intervention can increase healthcare costs. If you have a screening program, you find people with disease. Obviously, you may start to treat them, or you have a plan to deliver antiviral therapy earlier in disease. Added or earlier care will increase the health care costs. So when you put all of these factors together and compare the program costs to the health care costs, you arrive at the net cost of A. The cost of program adjusted for induced costs or saving minus the same type of net cost for B. That's the numerator. The denominator is the difference between options A and B in terms of one of several possible measures of health. In one cost effectiveness report, you can examine multiple outcomes. Let's start with natural health events. Examples are new infections, deaths averted, life years, or disease episodes. It's fine, and in fact, it's important to present the effectiveness of the program in terms of outcomes that people can understand, particularly when we are presenting to clinicians and other economists. Everyone can understand if you say it costs $1,000 to avert a new infection, or $500 to prevent a death, or $50 per added life year. This is the kind of statement that makes sense to all of our health colleagues. However, there are limits to what kind of comparisons we can make when we use natural health events. It's hard to compare a measles episode prevented to an added life year. This is why we use metrics like DALIS and QALIS. DALIS, or Disability Adjusted Life Years, are a measure of disease burden. By definition, they are undesirable. We want to avert DALIS. QALIS are a measure of health status, and therefore they are desirable. We want to gain them. Why do we go to the extra trouble of DALIS and QALIS? It's because we want to capture all of the effects of disease. If we look just at life years, we capture only the reduced mortality benefits of intervening. If we talk about quality of life, we might capture the effects of reducing morbidity. If we want to put it all together and compare across different diseases, that's when DALIS and QALIS become helpful, indeed essential. When we put the numerator and denominator together, we get the incremental cost effectiveness ratio, the difference in net costs divided by DALIS averted. Note that the order of subtraction in the numerator and the denominator is different, because the numerator is added costs, but the numerator is averted DALIS.
In segment number 3, we take a closer look at DALIS and QALIS, overarching uber metrics in health.